Jack Cook is a videographer who works with businesses and influencers in order to help them create promotional videos that helps them reach their customers, grow their brand, and tell their story. And he's going to tell us all about it in this interview. As well as that, the sponsor of this podcast is the European Hemp Company. Listeners can get £10 off their CBD oil, as well as free shipping, when they use the code BenLarryPodcast at checkout. Just go to europeanhempcompany.co.uk. As well as that, if you're the person in your household who's responsible for paying the bills, you could save money by switching to Utility Warehouse. Not only are they very competitive on rates, they'll come and install free LED light bulbs in your entire house at no cost, and they'll replace them for life. And so it really is a no-brainer kind of offer. So if you want to go and compare what you're already paying and check out if you could make any savings, go to benlarry.com/utilitywarehouse. Also, I'm a member of a property investing joint venture group, which is coached and mentored by a lady called Alex Louise Thomas. We're based in South Wales. And if you're interested in finding out more about that, you can go to benlarry.com/Alex. And if you know anybody that would make a good podcast guest, you can direct them to benlarry.com/podcast guest. And if you're interested in sponsoring the podcast, go to benlarry.com/sponsorship. Hey, Jack Kirk, how you doing?
Hello, Ben Larry. How are you?
Things are going well for you.
Things are on the up, up, up and up. Yeah, yeah. It's all going really well. Hard work, but yeah, the payoff is amazing. So strength to strength.
I'm going to describe to people what you do. You've basically kind of carved yourself a niche. You're a videographer, but you specialize in producing promotional video material for businesses. And you sort of do it in your own way. You kind of get behind the scenes and do it in a... What do you call it? Is it a documentary style? Like, what is it?
Yeah, I think it's safe to say documentary is the closest you can get to. You know, it's a bit candid, it's a bit raw. It's all about story. You know, it's not the sort of glamorized, filtered perception of what people do. It's getting down to nitty gritty and finding out exactly what they do and why it's important to them.
So when people see things like Gary Vaynerchuk on YouTube or something, and he's got, you know, the people are following him around and he's talking and it's all real and raw and, you know, it's unstaged, like you say. You're basically kind of providing that kind of service for people, right? You're going to people with your camera and you're figuring out what they need and you're producing something like that.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm influenced. I do look at what's going on, you know, stateside, because they're producing so much great content, video content. And it's not just the Gary V's, it's, you know, all the vloggers across, you know, YouTube and all the other social media platforms. I just love what they're doing. Their raw, you know, day-to-day lifestyle, you know, vlogs and really enjoying that candid behind the scenes stuff that, you know, isn't glamorized. And yeah, I want to bring that to people because I think we as a consumer are consuming more and more of that, and we are, you know, essentially buying from people when we buy from, you know, somebody that has these raw video diaries about their life and their business.
And when you go and work with someone, typically how long are you going to spend with them? Are you there a whole day or just an hour? How does it work?
You know, let's see what's, you know, what's going on. If it's if they've got a meeting, let's say, and it's an hour long, it's going to be an hour long, you know, with, you know, 20 minutes, you know, either side, just to capture some additional bits and pieces, maybe sort of like, you know, bookend the video itself. But that's about it. But if they've got an event going on and they want me to capture the whole day, then, you know, I'll be out for 8-9 hours plus editing. It really depends on what they want and what they're going to get from it. And often it's what I can suggest to them as well.
So it is a bespoke kind of service. So let's say, I don't know, I'm struggling to think of an example. I wanted to say an estate agency. I don't know why that came to mind. Like, if an estate agent approached you, is there something you could do for them?
Oh, absolutely. So let's just say they were, you know, selling free houses that day. They had, you know, different places to be. And then why not video diary from, you know, their car, moving from place to place, why it's important to them.
Hey. Listen up, people. This is your video man. This is your video fly on the wall guy that's going to follow you around, produce your snappy promo, you know, turn you into a sort of personality brand on Facebook. This is the guy that's going to do it.
Absolutely. Yes, I am your guy. And you can feel free to call me. I want to work with as many businesses, sort of boots on the ground businesses, as I can. I'm happy to go up to like Coca-Cola's CEO and film him for a day. That'd be exciting. But you know, I really like the people that are invested in what they do. They're excited about what they do. And you know, they might not think they have a story, and this is the best bit about it. They think, oh yeah, well, being an estate agent is pretty boring. All I do is sell houses. But there's so much in that. Why have you got into this position? Why is it important for that estate agent to sell this house to the right person, you know, and have that person have their forever home or somewhere to raise a baby or something like that? Why would you be in that business trying to sell these houses, you know, and what's your passion behind it? Why not choose any other career? There's so much someone could talk about whatever they do.
I've been interviewed by you, and you're good with questions. You are naturally inquisitive, and I am as well, by the way. You know, I do my podcast, I interview people. We're kind of similar like that. And you're good at bringing, like, someone could sit down in front of you, because I've done it, and you'll ask questions that evokes interesting answers, right? So if somebody works with you, they might not have an idea of what they're going to say on the camera, but you'll bring it out of them.
Exactly. You know, there is, I don't try and get people to rehearse. Rehearsing, you know, gives people this chance to do this sales pitch, but that goes kind of against the grain, and, you know, inevitably people turn off and certain things like that.
Yeah.
But yeah, if I ask the question, I will do a little bit of prompting, you know, and just say, you know, I'm asking this question because what a lot of people tend to do is, if I give them the chance to ask their own questions, they kind of just go around what they want to talk about. Rather than what their customer wants to hear. And that's the difference. And I always look at it as a customer consumer, which is why I, you know, create all these questions that are inquisitive. And actually, I do care when I ask these questions. I'm not just nodding just for the sake of it. I actually want to hear the answer. And that's why I really enjoy it. And that's where this all came from. And even if I didn't have a camera to do it, I would still ask these questions if I was chatting to anybody over a beer or something like that. You know, I definitely ask these questions. Like you said, naturally inquisitive. But I get to turn that into a story.
Also, another advantage you've got, JD, is you're a lean business in terms of you don't have crazy overheads. You don't have a big office full of staff and video editors and receptionists and assistants and bookkeepers. Like, you're very efficient, and what that means for your customers is the price what they're going to get from you is the kind of thing they pay twice or three times as much for from someone else, you know.
Exactly, you know, and I, my aim is to really, because there's so many businesses out there that literally can't afford video, because it is, and it's a want, not a need. So by keeping everything lean, keeping my overheads down, I still have to make money at the end of the day, but what's important for me is that everybody makes money from what I do. You know, so if somebody invests in me, they have to make money off the other end. So the more affordable I can make it, the easier it is for them to, you know, obviously make money off the end of it, and, you know, by promoting it and putting it across social media and building their audience via my videos.
Now, so tell us about the workshops, because there's many legs to your table, bow, so to speak.
Well, you know, my ultimate passion is people and people development, you know, and helping people grow and be better, you know. And for me, a lot of people... A lot of videographers would just walk into a business and just hope that somebody would sit in front of the camera. Or they pick somebody that maybe isn't the right person to talk to, just to sit in front of the camera, because they're quite able to talk in front of the camera. But there's so many businesses out there that could take advantage of using video that I developed this workshop called Video with Confidence, which is, it's ground, I don't want to say ground zero. It's a starting point. For people to actually get in front of the camera, build up that confidence, and realize there's nothing all that bad. I take them through all the processes, take them through the psychology, and I could bring them out the other end where they will have a video out in the world, and they'll realize that that hurdle is now very small, and it's not what they thought it was going to be, and it makes them a better person. And of course, again, they can now use video to grow and, you know, mature their business.
It's interesting, because a lot of people do have a mental block. Like, for us, we're used to working with video. We're used to it. You know, I've been doing it for years. I used to do video guitar lessons. Like, for 15 years, I've been recording stuff. So for us, it's no big deal. Now, for some people, It does feel like a big deal recording a video. And even though you're teaching them the technical how-tos, how to do the camera and the video editing and all that side of things, but also what you're offering people is the mental side and the encouragement to do it, and you make them do it and you get the ball rolling. And for a lot of people, that's actually the hurdle that is stopping them.
Well, there's some deep psychology, we're our own worst critics. So when we see ourselves on video or when we talk to an inanimate object, we always think that the ums and ahs and the way we look and, the way we say things and what we're actually saying is, terrible and nobody wants to hear it. We're embarrassing ourselves. Why the hell should we be doing it? But video is so important that if I can tackle those psychological barriers that they go, just drop them. Even for those 3 hours, just to get them to make that video, they come out the other end. And every time they try and record a video, they will go, ah, I know why I'm thinking like that. I know it's in my head. And actually, that last video I did with Jack, it did well. People were very nice about it. And now I can just move on and talk about my business myself and, progress with video. And it's, yeah, it is getting over that tiny barrier that people think is massive, like a giant wall that they need to climb. But actually, it's tiny and it's all in their head, and I just tell them that.
And what do you think? There's like a dichotomy. Some people feel like they need a very slick, very professional, very well-produced, high production standard video. And they may do. I'm not saying that's wrong. But then the other school of thought is to keep it very raw and real. And you could literally record into your phone like a selfie video with no production cost. And that could be equally as effective. Gary Vee does a lot of that phone camera stuff. A lot of the celebrities do, all of them, Grant Cardone, The Rock, they're all just recording little short snippets just into their phone. So what's the difference? Which one do you prefer? Is there a place for both? What's your view?
There definitely is a place for both. I think, sometimes you need a high production in order to articulate a product of yours, or where you work, or what your company ethos is. And there is that, but I personally, and I know a lot of people are disengaging from these videos because. If I liken it to a politician, that sounds a bit, don't want to go too far into politics, but I likened it to a politician. When they do a speech, you know that it is being well written by, a team of people, and just to make sure that that person looks good. And I always see that as, when I see a polished, upmarket video, I create these as well. And I feel the same about that. When you really high-end production value, or, nice polished filters, everything you need. I disengage because I think they're just telling me what I want to hear. And don't get me wrong, you can do that with raw video, but I think your personality comes out, your truth comes out when you're doing a more candid, more raw version of yourself. It's not rehearsed, it's literally you talking about yourself and your business. And for me, people are starting to resonate more and more with that. If you flick through any social media platform now, you will see that where the engagement is, and that is that raw video where people are just talking about their lives themselves, even the good days and bad days. There's so many different varieties of these raw videos that are going out that people will start to engage a lot more with that and the personalities behind them.
Storytelling is a buzzword that I hear a lot. Now, what does
yeah
that mean exactly?
so storytelling for me, any video needs to be some sort of journey. So I'm actually in between this, I'm actually recording a vlog, and it has to start with a mission, or you have to take the character, which is myself in this one, and put them in a situation where they've got to achieve something, and then they've got to go on the journey, and then there's got to be a resolution at the end. Now, this could be some literal Lord of the Rings style journey, or it can just be, real subtle, but it has to sort of go through that. For me, that's what storytelling is. But also, the storytelling element is it's got to be interesting to somebody else. What you're saying, what you're talking about has to be interesting. So, yes, yeah, storytelling is a buzzword, and I'm going to use it. I'm going to consistently use it because that's literally where I've got my skills from, in storytelling, from the whole narrative of how to create a story. So yeah, so that to me is very important, and everybody should be telling a story of some sort.
Now, you do have a background that lends itself to what you do now, right? You've done performance, you've done writing, you've done you work. Did you work for the BBC at one point?
Yeah, I don't want to get too much into that. It was very
No.
small and very minimal, but
Okay.
and it wasn't my cup of tea either. I mean, it is for people. It's a great career, but for me, I became part of the BBC rather than actually being Jack Cook. And yeah, I just yeah, my heart wasn't in it. But yeah, I've you know, I for years I was writing. I was a great student in English Lit. I used to read a hell of a lot when I was a kid. I used to write scripts, you know, just for. You know, why not? Just as a hobby. So, you know, I built on all of that. And then from about the age of 14, I think it was the first time we had a home video camera, I would go out with my brothers. You know, they're 7 years younger than me. So, yeah, I was the boss, I was the director, I was Spielberg. So, we're going to reenact Harry Potter, we're going to do Jurassic Park, we're going to do all these, you know, little videos recreated by me in our back garden. And then, you know, I got into editing from there, had to. And then I went on a process of working in TV production, spending time with editors, sitting behind them 8 hours a day, you know, watching them. They were teaching me, and I did that for sort of a couple of years, and yeah, inevitably came out the other end with all these skills that, you know, I didn't have before, and of course now, you know, I put them back into good use.
Yeah, good stuff. And you're killing it on you've been very clever with the way you've built your brand, your personal brand. You've leveraged LinkedIn a lot, right? And
Course.
what do you like about LinkedIn?
LinkedIn, as social media platforms go, Facebook is, you know, it's all about paid ads now, so you have to pay to get yourself in front of people and it's cluttered. Same as Instagram, it's going that way. Of course, that's Facebook as well. But, you know, that's going across all the platforms. But LinkedIn, even though it's not new, it's still fresh. The algorithm is amazing, but also my clients are on there. It's a B2B business that's finding its way into a sort of, it used to be a very formal and now a casual world. The algorithm is just beautiful. You know, it really looks after you. I've got videos from 2, 3 weeks ago still getting engagement. So for me, I'm all in on LinkedIn. I love sort of Instagram, not as keen on Facebook for my own business. But yeah, so yeah, LinkedIn's killing it. Not, and this is the best bit. Is hardly anybody is utilizing video. So if anybody's listening to this and they're thinking, well, you know, I'm competing with too many, you know, people in the insurance industry, let's say, then get on video because Instagram, sorry, LinkedIn loves it, and it'll, you know, it'll carry that video far, just as long as you use storytelling and you make it on point with your brand.
Do you have different packages that you offer people? Is there di like if they want to just start off with a like working with you just to see what it's like as a taster, or is it really just bespoke every time?
A lot of it's bespoke. I mean, the raw vloggy stuff, it has to be bespoke because it's different for different people, different areas, different things I have to do and achieve, and different stories to tell each time, which is fine by me, but it has to be bespoke because it has to depend on the person, because it has to be their character and their flavor. But I do offer certain videos for websites, and you know, various other videos. Like what I'm getting into now, and yeah, if anybody's listening to this and you're a speaker, my next product that I'm selling, not bespoke, is a speaker package where I'll go in and film a speaker, and you know, cover their 20 minutes, 30 minutes, and I'll take that and I'll break it down into as many pieces of content as I can. You know, take out sound bites, turn that into a piece of content, take another sound bite out, turn that into a big. So they could end up with 4, you know, to 8 pieces of great content, from that one video. And then obviously transcribe it so they can use it in blogs, rip the sound so they can use it in audio for podcasts,
Right.
take pictures from it, and you know, and so on and so forth. So that's my latest package, and that's the one.
Right. So someone does a presentation on stage or a keynote speech or a
Yeah.
meeting or something. You capture that. You then extract or multiple different sort of media assets out of it so they can end up with images, sound bites, short little things, and then they can upload that sort of over time, so they got a drip feed of content.
Exactly. Because what a lot of people do, and I've seen this time and again, is they will, you know, do their 20 minutes at, you know, on a stage, an exhibition of some sort. Then they'll, you know, then they'll be trying to get their next gig. But what they'll be doing is manufacturing content, you know, images or some pictures that were taken, or you know, maybe a quote from someone. But actually, if you're trying to sell you speaking, why, you know, why not sell you speaking? Use that as your marketing factor. Also, you know, with, if you've got 20 minutes, so I can break it down into the 6 pieces of content, that's 6 weeks of content that people are going to see consistently throughout their newsfeed, especially, as I said, on LinkedIn. And I think that's important. And of course, they can utilize the images, the sound, and also create blog posts out the transcriptions. So they are literally everywhere. Yeah, everywhere. And that works. That's what brand building's about.
Anybody listening to this, I want them to get in contact with Jack and get his services quick, because what I'm going to tell him now, I want him to put his prices up because he's too cheap. So contact him today before I persuade him to put his prices up, because I think he does too much work for too little money, I think.
Yes, I do. At the moment, yes, with this speaker package, because it's fresh and new to me, I want people to engage with it. But yes, there's no convincing. My prices are definitely going to go up, so people do need to get in real quick and make it happen.
We didn't plan to say that. I'm serious. I think you should double his prices, and I think you should get in there quick now.
I appreciate that. You sold it to me.
What else is going on? Is there anything else I don't know about?
So don't really. I'm just out there networking. I'm a big advocate of promoting people. If people are doing a good thing, my vlogs are going to be sort of centered around what businesses are doing in and around Bristol. You know, with my spin on it, my talk and whatnot. So I'm just getting out there and just talking to people. I'm up and down the country filming as well, which is real nice, because I get to explore new areas. But yeah, just keeping my head down, getting on with it, driving forward, and just making sure that, business is coming my way. I have a voice out there. People know who I am. And the fact that I love doing that anyways, it's brilliant. So that's what I'm busy doing, just keeping that real. And of course, I've got some speaking gigs coming up. There's one called the Speaking Academy with Nick Elston. So if anybody's listened to this, look up Nick Elston. It's in Bristol at the Metro Bank late next month. I'll confirm that date. But that's going to be worth it, because I'm going to be talking to speakers about how they can, absolutely smash it, smash their speaking gigs with video, which is obviously very apt with my current offerings.
Nice one, JD. That's awesome stuff.
Top man, Ben. Well, I always appreciate chatting to you, mate. Loving the podcast, loving what you're doing. I'm gonna put my prices up. Everybody, you got a special offer on Ben. I'll keep prices as they are. If you get in quick, just quote Ben Lowry.
Yeah, if you tell Jack that you heard him on the Ben Lowry podcast, he may just do you a deal at the existing rate.
Or you might get a free t-shirt, I don't know, one of the other.
All right, JD, good stuff.
Top man, we'll catch up again soon, and keep up the good work, my friend.
All right, thank you. You too.
Thanks for having me on. Cheers.
Bye.